The reason that we're gathered together is a conversation Bishop Chip and I had about helping all of us who lead in worship to understand some of the changes that are being made in the liturgy and understand the whys and what's behind them so that we can help our people through them. The prayer book is this just amazing resource that is peculiar in one sense to Anglicans, in that the Reformation, in all of the work in the Reformation, most of the Reformation was confessional. You think about the Westminster Confession, the Augsburg Confession. When you turn to the Church of England, what you've got is the Book of Common Prayer. And it was Cranmer's particular insight, and those who surrounded him, that if we could get everybody to pray the same way, they would actually come to believe the same way. And they're praying the same way, we would actually produce a level of unity that couldn't be achieved any other way. So as the Anglican Church in North America came together almost 10 years ago now, it was clear to the bishops that a very high priority for us was to get a common language of prayer, to have that among us. Again, you'll recall that in the organization of the province, we said that all of the prayer books then in use were appropriate for continuing use in the province. And indeed, last summer at the Provincial Council, we passed a resolution which was approved by the Assembly, which said that that all of those prayer books which were in use can still be used, but that we are moving toward a standard Book of Common Prayer. And so we're well along in that process. The three priorities for our province in the years when I was privileged to be your Archbishop were to plant 1,000 churches. Again, the kind of mission imperative, let's try to grow the church in the most the means that works better than any other. If you want to grow churches, and as Tim Keller says, plant churches. If you want to grow Christian faith in the city, plant more churches. It's the best way to do that. It was also clear that we needed a catechism for a post-Christian era, and so one of the things we set about was to produce To Be a Christian, which many of you have and use, and it has now been translated into 15 languages. So useful to the church throughout the world. And the third matter was this matter of a language of common prayer. There was, and I think that the Liturgy Task Force was originally led by Bishop Bill Thompson, who was Bishop of Western Anglicans. It was a committee that I appointed with the concurrence of the College of Bishops and began work. And the first thing that they recently began was that there needed to be a theological paper which would guide how we made decisions. And it's available online, as are so many of the resources related to liturgy, principles of Christian worship, in additional resources on the Liturgy tab of the provincial website, and you've seen that. We refer to that as the lens through which we look when we're trying to make the decisions about what would be the correct calendar would be constructed. When I ceased to be the Archbishop, and when Archbishop Foley asked me if I'd take over the Liturgy Task Force, which we all understood was not because I knew the most about liturgy, Bishop is very kind, but because I heard cats better than most. And the task to get everybody to agree about liturgy was one of those urgent tax operations. I will say that we're blessed in this diocese of the 12-member committee that is working on the prayer book. We've got Andrew Lombardo there, Canon Lombardo, the other Canon Lombardo, who's a member of the committee. And of course, many of you remember Dr. Arne Klukas. Pittsburgh has three of the 12 members, but we keep that secret outside. It wasn't that. It has to do with gifts and graces.
The lens that was adopted for our work can be boiled down to the four values. And I just want to share with you, as you think about it, you share with your people how this prayer book is coming to be.
The first of the principles or values is continuity. I mean, is the prayer book continuous on this heritage that we have as Anglicans? Indeed, for us, if you think about what both the Jerusalem Declaration says and the fundamental principles of the province, fundamental declaration, they say that the 1662 Book of Common Prayer is the standard doctrine of worship. It's a pretty strong statement. It has to do with continuity. What have Anglicans always believed and how they always worshiped? The second principle was memorability. Okay, I was with an Afghan vet this morning, and he shared how in Afghanistan, going through something that the troops called the gauntlet, with two warring factions on either side of the road, how what came back to him was the text of the Greek hymn that his parents had taught him. Just recited all day long in a row. Again, memorability. Kramer had a particular understanding that passages of scripture repeated in the liturgy would come to shape God's people. It's why, until 1928, you actually had to say 10 commandments every Sunday. Okay? That was a shock to kind of 21st century, but you had to say 10 commandments every Sunday. And after 1662, you had to also say the summary of the law in the Athenian version. Okay? See, those were pretty big pieces of scripture. But then, of course, there were the comfortable words. Anybody can read home four verses of scripture. These four were the four that Cranmer thought everybody wanted to know. They were rehearsed. And so, memorability, a huge piece of the work. And one of the principles in the Fuller paper, the principles of Christian worship, that relates to that is don't disturb the piety of the people if you don't need to. Okay? When we get to the certain corner, you'll see that up is back. Okay? One, when you lift, you know, you always lift up. And it was just a big change. So don't disturb the piety of the people. Memorability. Now, it gets in them, and that's English Reformation had in mind, that's what this tradition has in mind. These words repeated over and over, particularly words of scripture or ideas that are in scripture, these things will shape the people profoundly. Third principle, either say musicality or poetry. Again, can you sing it? What's its meter? How does it end? One of the issues that we have in the contemporary church, and on every other level, having pew Bibles is great, but reading the Psalter from a pew Bible is a disaster. Because the So musicality or poetry as concerns for the book. And finally, clarity. Okay? Is it clear to a contemporary viewer? And you can see when you begin to put these kind of four principles here that you sometimes have some tensions, like the issue between continuity and clarity can be a significant